Good evening. My name is Osama Khan, Pro Vice Chancellor Academic, and I'm really honored to be the MC, of this program today. Welcome to all of our guests, both at the University of Surrey, right in front of me, and everybody who is online, but especially tonight's honored speaker, Professor Usha Goswami. I've been looking forward to this event for some time. In fact, ever since I started to follow Usha's work, it really excites me to see the groundbreaking research that Usha is doing and how that changes education. And being a lead on education at the university, that really inspires me because I think Professor Goswami's work is a perfect example how research and education can come together and really create a nexus. It feels particularly pertinent to have Professor Goswami with us here tonight, because as a research-focused community, we need to hear from an authority like Professor Goswami to ensure our inclusive education journey, the journey that we have started, but long way to go. So without further ado, I'm going to welcome the President and the Vice-Chancellor of our university, Professor Max Liu.
Thank you very much, Osama. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and of course, our honoured speaker, Usha Goswami. Welcome to this year's University of Surrey's Adams Sweeting Lecture, and this is the first time in person in 3 years, and although we had two online in the past 2 years. So I'm so delighted to host Professor Goswami as our distinguished speaker. Actually, I know Usha through the work that we did at the Prime Minister's Council for Science Technology on technology enabling the learning outcomes for children with learning disability. And she has contributed a lot to that work, which has been accepted by the Prime Minister, by the way, and then the Ministry, the Department of Education is charged, tasked to implement the recommendations. So, but tonight's topic is about languages, dyslexia, and rhythms, and you know how the developing brains differ in various children's. So, the power of words and the impact of language are often undervalued in our society. I'm certain that you found Usha's lecture to be enlightening and thought-provoking. Of course, this lecture series, the Adam Sweeting Lecture, has a proud history of hearing from the eminent speakers at the forefront of science and technology at the University of Surrey. It is, of course, named in honour of Professor Alf Adams and Sir Martin Sweeting, and both of whom here, very pleased to see both join us tonight. Although they need no introduction to this audience, it would be remiss of me not to pay tribute to their extraordinary achievements in science and technology. And to Professor Alf Adams for inventing the strand layer quantum well laser, and to Professor Sir Martin Sweeting for pioneering modern small satellites. The impact of their world-changing discoveries and inventions are simply huge. Science continues to push boundaries of knowledge through language and education, translating ideas and self-belief, and the most important, focus on impactful solutions. Tonight, we are privileged to hear our distinguished speaker, who is a leader in neuroscience and technology and education, Professor Usha Goswami, on the topic of dyslexia, rhythm, language, and the developing brain. Her ongoing studies into identifying how the neural processes of typically developing children differ from those of children with dyslexia or children with other developmental language disorders. And such studies are truly inspirational. Usha is the director of the Center for Neuroscience in Education at the University of Cambridge. In 2019, she received the education equivalent of the Nobel Prize, the Idan Prize for Educational Research, for her work in educational neuroscience, language and literacy. The Royal Society elected her last year as a fellow, citing her fundamental contributions to understanding how individual differences in children's phonological awareness, or word sound structure, underpin reading development and dyslexia across languages. Last year, she was also awarded a CBE for her service to educational research. So Usha's lecture tonight is also very, very timely for Surrey, given that we have achieved tremendous success in the REF results recently. In particular, I mentioned the relevant areas, health professions, and languages and literature and education. And also given that we have recently have made strategic plans in the School of Psychology, particularly in terms of developing innovative science and evidence-based solutions through multidisciplinary research for optimizing and accelerating learning across the lifespan. Communication and collaboration remain an integral part of our future innovation. So I would like to salute Usha for her dedicated and pioneering research on phonology to benefit all children and for opening our eyes and ears to the gift of language on which our cultures, societies and communities are built. So ladies and gentlemen, now without further ado, can I hand back to Osama to formally introduce Usha and before she starts the lecture. Osama.
Thank you, Max. I'm not going to take too long, but I thought we need to reflect quickly on who do we have among ourselves. I've been a long admirer of Professor Goswami's work because how she reflected as a teacher at the beginning of her career and realized that there is something to be done more profoundly about children with this neurodiversity. The neuroscience behind this diversity will improve their educational practice, and that was her ambition. And that's exactly what she managed to achieve through her research to help millions of children. I remember when I first became aware of her work, I was struck by the level of Usha's conviction to make good for these children, the children with neurodiversity, around 15%, they say, in United Kingdom and about 30 to 40% across the globe. So the research impact is profound if we really understand how to help these young children. There is still a lot of stigma, taboo, and misunderstanding in providing the best chance to the neurodivergent population of this world through education. And I remember a popular movie in South Asia, the part of the world I'm from, called Tare Zameen Par. Tare Zameen Par, it means stars on the earth, which played a significant role in explaining dyslexia and dyspraxia to the vast population of South Asian community. It shows the power of entertainment art as well in educating a community. All these years later, I was looking into Usha's research, and she's currently involved in a research that chimes with what we do at Surrey. So we have a brain and behavioral research group led by Professor Bartram Opitz. When Dr. Catherine Cohen-Kadosh is leading a social brain and development lab, and Professor Roy Cohen-Kadosh, our head of psychology at Surrey, is an authority in cognitive learning. And I do feel the stars on earth has aligned for Surrey, and this is a time for us to forge a friendship with Usha to work together. When I think about Usha's career so far, I could not fail to notice how visionary her parents must be to name her Usha. In my language, and as well as the language probably Usha's parents shared, it means dawn in Sanskrit, a time of the day that symbolizes renewal, rebirth, and all things life-affirming. And Usha, you just have done that for millions of children through your research. What a successful career you have had. I'd now like to hand over to a true pioneer of research in this area for tonight's lecture, Professor Usha Goswami.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much, Osama, and also Max, for these really nice introductions. I'm sorry about my coughing. I actually lost my voice completely last week, so I'm hoping it will hold out for the lecture. So I'll spend about 45 minutes giving you an overview of the way I've approached the problem of dyslexia and the kind of research we're doing at the Centre for Neuroscience in Education to try to help understand what happens for the children who present with dyslexia when they come to school. And really the focus of the talk is on development, because as soon as the baby is born, in fact, even in the womb, the baby is exposed to speech. And speech is a really important signal if you're a human being, because you need to acquire a good spoken language system to be part of your community. And of course, once we invented reading and writing, you know, this was a relatively late cultural invention, but then it became very important that you could also acquire speech written down, because in a way that's what reading is. It's still speech processing, but you're using a visual code. And that's where we find some children just don't seem to have the same, you know, it's the same brain functions that you need to build that system for processing speech when it's written down. So learning to read is probably one of the most complicated tasks the brain achieves. And the most obvious thing for a parent when a child is starting to learn to read is that now suddenly there are books involved, there's visual information. And so for a long time, theories of dyslexia were based on visual system problems, that perhaps the visual system doesn't function the same way as in other children. For example, there might be a problem with visual motion processing, which means it's difficult for the eyes to converge on a single letter. But the more research that's been done, the more it's been recognized that actually the problem in dyslexia for most children is with the speech processing system. But speech has so many redundant cues, because it's such an important thing to learn, that most of the time you don't realize there's anything wrong with the child's speech processing system until they go to school and they're faced with the task of learning to read. And then all of a sudden, children who are very verbal, very bright, very engaged children, you know, they're trying very hard, but they're stumbling and struggling to learn to read. And this happens in every language in the world. And so the goal of my research program is, what is the underlying cause or causes that would apply whichever language your brain is exposed to when you come out of the womb and you start learning speech? So probably in the last 20 or 30 years, I would say, child psychology has really been looking at markers of problems with reading and writing at the cognitive level. And the key cognitive discovery is that there's a problem for children with developmental dyslexia with regard to phonology. So phonology is basically the sound structure of any language. It's what kinds of sounds make words, what order are those sounds in the words, do words rhyme with each other, how many syllables in words. All of these are aspects of phonology. So it's been shown now in, every language that's been tested actually, that children who are struggling with reading also struggle with what's called phonological awareness tasks. So things like deciding whether words rhyme, counting the number of syllables in a word, or deciding whether, say, cat and cop begin with the same sound. All of these tasks, which are oral language tasks, are difficult for children with dyslexia. And furthermore, individual differences in how well you perform those tasks, even if you don't have a reading problem, predict how well you learn to read and write. So there seems to be a causal connection between phonology and reading. Also, what these studies have done, so we're mainly looking at preschoolers to early primary years, so say ages 3 to 7. In language after language, there seems to be a universal pattern that children can reflect and manipulate larger units of phonology first. So probably the primary unit is the syllable. So children can reflect on syllable patterning in words. So if you give them a drumstick and they have to drum to say wigwam or caterpillar, they can do these tasks long before they're taught about print. Children can do rhyming tasks. Does cat rhyme with hat? Yes. Does cat rhyme with cot? No. It's only with teaching that children become aware of these smaller units of sound that are reflected by the alphabet. So the smaller units of sound are called phonemes, And again, cross-language research, particularly in the Western European languages, has shown that it's not the age at which you go to school that matters for phoneme awareness, it's the age at which you start being taught to read. If you're an illiterate adult who's never been taught to read, you actually have very poor phoneme awareness. You're not sure whether cat and cop start with the same sound, for example. So these smaller units of awareness, which are actually the basis of the way we teach phonics in this country at the moment, but they're something that comes through the experience of being taught to read. Phonology, before you start learning to read, is about these larger sound structures in words like the syllable and the rhyme. So one way of thinking about this is in terms of the linguistic hierarchy. So this is at the single word level. Of course, you could also have whole phrases, but at the single word level, we can think of stressed and unstressed syllables. So in a language like English, we have a lot of content words or nouns in which the first syllable is stressed. So the example here is garden. So I've put capital letters for the stressed syllable. Garden, daddy, mummy, baby. All of these words have a strong, weak syllable stress pattern. And the syllable stress pattern carries the speech rhythm. Then we can think about the individual syllables in the word. So garden has two syllables, the sounds gar and the sounds dun. And then another level of phonology that has been identified by linguistics is this so-called onset rhyme level. So the onset rhyme is spelled differently from rhyming cat and hat, because if you have a multisyllabic word, it has a large number of rhymes in it. So I've just got these two syllables, garden, but to divide any syllable into onset rhyme, you divide at the vowel. So the first sound or the onset in the syllable gar is g. The second sound is R. The first sound or the onset in the syllable den is D, and then the rhyme pattern would be N. So depending on which word it is, there can be more or less, more or fewer phonemes that make up these onsets and rhymes. Mm-hmm. And English actually has a very complex phonological structure. So we have single syllables like the word stamp or the word stream, where you might have three phonemes before in the onset before you get to the rhyme. All of that actually makes it harder to learn to read. But again, this essential point is that the phoneme level, so that we divide further, g, this is actually just a single phoneme, r, it's a vowel r sound, or d, dun would be d, n. This phoneme level seems to come largely from being taught the alphabet. It's not something that's naturally there as part of development. The levels you get as a natural part of learning a spoken language system seem to be these three levels. And I've written start here because there's a lot of research that I won't have time to discuss on infant language acquisition. Across languages, the rhythm pattern of the language is where babies start. So you can show, for example, that newborn babies can distinguish languages from different rhythm classes, like, say, Dutch versus Russian, because they've heard through the fluid in the womb, they've heard that basic rhythmic structure of their spoken language. And so when they come out of the womb, they already know that. So there's a lot of literature suggesting babies start with speech rhythm, and speech rhythm is carried by these syllable stress patterns. Where are the strong syllables? Where are the weak syllables? Now, interestingly, in developmental dyslexia, when people started looking beyond this phoneme level, because, of course, children with dyslexia struggle to learn grapheme-phoneme connections or letter-sound correspondences, it was realised that actually children with dyslexia have problems at every single level of phonological structure in our spoken languages. So they have problems with the stress syllable level. They find it very hard to hear stress patterns, actually. They have trouble dividing words into syllables, and they have trouble with this onset rhyme distinction. They find it difficult to divide syllables into onsets and rhymes. And they also have problems with phonemes. But in terms of developmental trajectories, that problem comes rather later than these other levels of phonology. And if you're a child who has dyslexia learning, say, Spanish or Italian, you can develop very good phoneme awareness, actually, because you're learning a very unambiguous spelling system where one letter only ever makes one sound. These children develop phoneme awareness. They can be quite accurate. The problem for them in terms of functional reading is that they're very, very slow, because this has all been rote learned. It's not something that just pops out of their spoken language system as it might do for a child without dyslexia. So children with dyslexia don't have a problem only at the phoneme level, They have a problem at every level of phonology. And that's what made me interested in thinking about, well, what are phonological representations like then before we learn to read? So basically, you're a baby, you're acquiring your spoken language system. Phonological representation just means these sound patterns that your brain has learned that reflect words in your language. So whichever language you're learning, you need to figure out where are the words, and usually speech rhythm patterns help you find where the words are. So I already mentioned that in English we tend to have strong, weak syllable patterning, like daddy, mummy, baby. So if you're an infant by the age of about 7 months who's learning English, you've already learned the rule that the first syllable will be a heavy, strong syllable. That's probably where the word begins. So you can show that with experiments. But again, in language after language, it seems that babies begin with speech rhythm or prosodic structure. And if you look at how we talk to babies, so baby talk or so-called motherese or parentese or infant-directed speech, we intuitively exaggerate these rhythm patterns. So we speak much more rhythmically when we're speaking to a baby, even though we're not aware of it, and we really emphasize prosodic structure. So that sort of sing-song up and down way that you talk to babies is really helping the language learning brain. And it's helping the brain through rhythm and prosody, these syllable stress patterns. So what that means developmentally then is if that's where babies begin, then maybe if we're trying to understand dyslexia, that's where we have to start. How does the brain process speech rhythm? What kind of cues are important? And how well does the dyslexic brain encode speech rhythm patterns? Now, the other crucial thing about speech, I said it's one of the most complex things the brain learns, is multimodal. So there's rhythm in all these modalities. It's not just the acoustic rhythm, actually. The brain is also using motor rhythm. When babies start trying to produce speech, they're babbling, ba-ba-ba, ma-ma-ma. They're producing rhythmic structures at the very beginning. And then there's also a lot of visual rhythm on the face and in the head movements. So again, this isn't widely researched. Everybody thinks about lip reading. But actually, as well as your lips moving, when you're speaking, you'll make head movements in time with stressed syllables, or the way that your cheeks and jaw deforms as you speak is also a cue to these speech rhythm structures. And also, you'll notice when you see, journalists on the news, you can't help waving your hands in time with speaking, especially when you're trying to emphasize a point. That hand waving is linked to these speech rhythm patterns again. So there are multimodal cues to rhythm. I'm going to focus in this talk on the acoustic speech signal. That doesn't mean that these other modalities aren't important. And I'm also going to talk about how we think the brain encodes rhythm, which is through these rhythmic brain waves. We know the brain works through brain waves. These are thought of as oscillations, so whole networks of cells that are oscillating in the sense of they're either sending a pulse of electrical energy or they're recovering, so they're basically on, off, on, off, in a rhythmic pattern, and they use lots of different timescales for that rhythmic oscillatory firing, but that's the basic mechanism by which the brain works. So I'll show you some of the behavioural data, and then I'll show you some of the neural data. So behaviourally, why do we think children with dyslexia struggle with speech rhythm? Well, we developed a whole range of tasks in the last couple of decades to try to study this. And this is a good example, the DD task. So in the DD task, you take a well-known phrase, or we also had famous names for children like Harry Potter, and you replace every syllable with one syllable, the same phonetic sound, D, and then you make those D strong or weak. So for Harry Potter, it would be DD, DD. Or for Jack and Jill went up the hill, D, 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 D. So the task for the child is that they'll see a picture, like a picture of the nursery rhyme or the picture of Harry Potter, and they'll hear these DDs, one of which is matching the picture and one of which isn't. So for Harry Potter, D, 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 D would be the match, whereas if they heard D, 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 the Lion King, that would not be the match for Harry Potter. And what we found was that children with dyslexia really were more or less set chance on this task. They found it very, very difficult to tell which DD went with the pictures. They actually were worse with the longer pieces of language, which I hadn't predicted, because I thought it'd be more obvious which is the right answer when you've got more linguistic structure. And not only were children with dyslexia worse at this task than children of the same age as them, they were also worse than younger children who could read the same number of words. So that's an important developmental experimental control, is if you have a child who is 10 years old who's reading like a 7-year-old, that 10-year-old's brain has only had the same amount of reading input as a typically reading 7-year-old. So if you think there's a cognitive level or sensory level problem, you also need to test that idea against reading level matched children who are the same reading level as the children with dyslexia but much younger. So all the cognitive advantages should be with the older dyslexic children, and yet in tasks like this, they're not. The children with dyslexia are worse, the 10-year-olds with dyslexia are worse than the 7-year-olds without dyslexia at deciding which DD pattern matches Harry Potter. That made us think, well, what about non-speech rhythm? Because one of the most obvious rhythmic activities we ever do is we tap in time to a beat. And so to make an experiment, we had a metronome going tick, 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 and the child just had to go tap, tap, tap in time with whichever beat rate they were listening to. We had a range of rates. And what we found was that children with dyslexia were actually incredibly bad at keeping in time with the metronome. So they were particularly poor the slower the metronome beat, but it was very hard to keep in time. They were much more variable than other children, and that variability in their timekeeping predicted significant amounts of variance in their reading and spelling abilities. So this motor rhythm task that seemed totally divorced from learning to read and write is actually a predictor of how well you learn to read and write. So there's something fundamental about rhythm. So we thought, well, maybe we can remediate that problem with music. So we devised some so-called musical rhythm tasks, and I'll give you one example here. That we had a range of different metrical complexities. I'll play you one very simple one. The beat rate was always 500 milliseconds or 2 hertz, twice a second. And the children just had to listen to these tunes and say whether they were the same or different in rhythm. So I think that the technicians will play an example now, and you just have to listen and say same or different. Same or different? That was different, very good. So that was one of the simpler examples, but actually it didn't matter how many notes or how simple or difficult. The children with dyslexia, again, they cannot hear this metrical structure. They found it very difficult to know whether these tunes were the same or different. And just as with the DD task, they were also worse than younger children matched for reading level. Individual differences in this task were predicting about 40% of variability in reading and spelling, which is a lot of the variance. And again, it just pointed to this idea that there's something fundamental about rhythm that the dyslexic brain finds difficult. So what I'm trying to do in the talk is I move from the cognitive level, where we were talking about difficulties with phonology. Now at the sensory level, I'm saying, well, there's a problem with rhythm. So one way of thinking about this linguistically is that children with dyslexia have some kind of fundamental problem in recovering the rhythmic structure or the prosodic structure from the speech signal. Why do they have these rhythmic difficulties? Well, then we need to start thinking, how does the brain encode rhythm? And could that point out to us where in the dyslexic brain the problem is occurring? So I'll talk a bit more about neural oscillations. So basically, the way our brain processes the sensory world is in snapshots. Because the brain cells can either be on or off, they're not like recording a camcorder of all of your experience. Each network of cells has a sort of related job to the other networks, but they're sampling bits of that experience. So, for example, in the visual field, you know, you'll have different cell networks sampling different wavelengths of light. We all take that for granted. But the same thing is true in the auditory world. You've got different networks in auditory cortex that are oscillating or naturally firing at different temporal rates. So some of them are firing twice a second, some are firing five times a second, some are firing 80 times a second. There are lots of different temporal rates. And their job really is to find in the speech signal an energy pattern that's at their temporal rate, latch onto it, and then all of their kind of work gets added together in your perceptual experience. You're totally unaware of this. You just hear somebody talking. So the basic idea, which isn't my own idea, but which has been shown in adult auditory neuroscience, is that speech is a very complex signal, and the brain deals with that through multi-time resolution. So you've got these oscillating networks of cells, and they're working at different temporal rates. Some are fast, some are slow. They have their own bit of energy change in the speech signal, which they latch onto. What you get as the listener is that integrated perceptual experience of somebody speaking. So it means that all of these phonological representations that children are developing for words in their language, like, you know, the sound pattern of garden or banana, is being built up through these oscillating networks, which, again, would be in more than one modality, but we're just thinking about speaking and listening to the auditory signal, all of these oscillating networks doing their job on time. So what we're going to do now is move from the spoken language level, the cognitive level of phonology, the sensory level to acoustic rhythm, to think about the neural level, how these oscillations work. And a good metaphor for thinking about your brain is it's a bit like fireflies. So I don't know if people here have seen fireflies, but they're very beautiful to watch. They're just these little flickering dots of light that move around the visual field, and they're either on or off. You know, the firefly will be sending its little pulse or recovering. And usually they're all working at random. But if they were actually your brain cells and an environmental source of energy came in, so there was some signal in the environment that you had to take account of, say somebody in that forest started beating a drum, and all of these fireflies decided to signal in time with the drum, then you'd have, in effect, a neural oscillation. You'd have a peak of electrical energy and a trough, a peak and a trough, and they'd be firing in time with that drum beat. And in a very simplified way, that's what the brain does too. So here, for example, is an example of... So these are individual neurons who are spiking, and then if you average the across here what's happening in that particular network, you see that there's a very regular oscillation. And this is an example of an alpha oscillation, so 10 times a second is called alpha. So you've got the individual cells firing, but you've also got the whole network which is producing this oscillation. And there are different core rates in the brain. So alpha is thought to be particularly important for attention, for example. In terms of speech, there are other rates that seem to be important. And here's an example of what happens for one of these other rates, which is five times a second, or theta, when someone starts speaking. So basically, this is showing individual cells in the network, which are, you know, noodling around, firing randomly. And then at this time point, somebody starts speaking. This is an example of the speech signal. And suddenly, they all synchronize themselves to be in time with their bit of energy in that speech signal. So this is something automatic. It's something your brain does, just like if you open your eyes and there's light, your brain will start processing the visual field. So somebody starts talking, there's a cue in the speech signal, which is the rate of change of energy or amplitude rise time, which just means how loud something gets and how quickly it gets loud. These rise times seem to cause phase resetting. So the network is working at random. This strong cue comes in from the environment of a rise in amplitude, and it causes these networks to reset their phase of firing so that they're now more or less in time with that particular energy pattern or rhythmic pattern in the speech signal. So the idea then is we know that language is encoded in part via these neural oscillations. So that had already been shown by the adult neuroscience literature. And I myself had been interested in speech rhythm in children with dyslexia, and amplitude rise times are actually very important when you speak deliberately to a rhythm. So I'd been studying these amplitude rise times and finding that children with dyslexia were very insensitive to them. So when this research started coming out about oscillatory phase resetting, then it became, you know, the obvious question to explore was, well, if these children can't hear these rise times very well, what's happening when they're trying to oscillatory phase reset? Well, they're not trying because they can't control it, but what's happening when their brain is hearing a speech signal and trying to phase reset these oscillations that are so important for interpreting and comprehending that speech signal? And the adult literature had suggested that there were four different rates of oscillation that were particularly important in speech, so-called delta, theta, beta, and gamma. And the slowest one of these is delta, which is roughly twice a second. And in terms of the way the mechanisms work in the brain, you get nesting, so that the delta rhythm will control the phase of the theta rhythm, and the delta rhythm, or the phase of the delta, will control the amplitude of beta. The phase of theta controls the amplitude of gamma, which means, you know, how many cells are firing. So basically, it's a mechanistic information hierarchy in the brain, in the way this works, and it's governed by these delta band oscillations, actually the slowest rate. But that was very interesting to me, because I'd been doing those chime bar and so on tapping tasks where 2 hertz was a rate that I kept finding problems in dyslexia. And also there's another literature in linguistics which looks at how often people speaking different languages produce a stressed syllable. And on average, people will produce a stressed syllable twice a second, whichever language they're speaking. So that would be a very strong sensory marker for the language learning brain of the infant. If the brain can function well at this 2 hertz oscillation, then they'd be getting those landmarks in the speech signal that are these stressed syllables. And they'd be getting those landmarks whichever language system they were born into. So I was very interested in looking at delta oscillations in the dyslexic brain. So what we decided to do was to try to link this theoretically in terms of, so we've had phonology, we've had the problems with rhythm, so rise times and amplitude modulation. So amplitude modulation just means rises and falls in energy patterns. And you can think about the speech signal as a 3D landscape or a seascape maybe. So if you think about looking to the horizon at the seaside, you've got all these waves. Some of them are bigger than others. Sometimes there's a real cresting wave, but there's also lots of other little tremors on the surface of the sea. There's a lot going on in that 3D landscape. And you can think about the job of the language learning brain as representing that entire 3D landscape. These great big waves are very important. I'm saying that possibly those are the ones linked to these stressed syllables that are a landmark across languages for where's the information in the speech signal. But the other ones are important too. So although I'm going to stress now this particular delta band level, actually the dyslexic brain has to get all of the levels correct for a really pure speech percept. And because we already knew that the speech signal has lots of these different rates of amplitude modulation, and these networks in your auditory cortex depend on these rise times, which children with dyslexia can't hear very well, to phase reset, this seemed like a good avenue of exploration. So another metaphor, just for thinking about this, I thought I'd use Irish dancers, because in terms of what your brain is doing, everybody in their network has to be on time. So when you're doing Irish dancing, you're trying to only move your feet, but that your feet have to move to hit bang on the beat. And so what would be the analog for the brain is that your delta band oscillations, your theta band, or 5 times a second, your beta band, say 20 times a second, all of these oscillating networks in your auditory cortex are bang on the beat. You've got perfect phase synchronization. That gives you the best possible percept of the speech signal, the best possible sensory representation of this crucially important input. And another way of thinking about this is what that means for what phonology is, like learning the speech sound system of any language, because most textbooks in speech processing will show you the speech signal like this panel on the top. So we've got time along here, we've got frequency on this axis, We've got the number words here. 9 starts here and finishes here. 9, 7 starts there and finishes there. And the main thing one notices in the frequency domain is lots of rapid change around the production of the vowel. But there's no very obvious cues for when the word begins or ends. By contrast, if you map time along here and you map amplitude or signal intensity on this axis, you can see there's a very clear sort of blob for each syllable. So the amplitude modulation is giving you information about structure that's complementary to frequency modulation. And when you have a bisyllabic word like the word 7, so that's a strong weak syllable pattern, 7, you've got a bigger amplitude modulation cue for the stressed syllable compared to the unstressed syllable. And in fact, when cochlear implants were being developed, the engineers realized that what was really important wasn't so much representing this entire spectral range of speech in terms of these frequencies, but having the so-called amplitude envelope, which is basically the power-weighted average of all these changes. So the envelope you'd get by sort of drawing round this raw signal. Having that represented by these electrodes in the implant. So most cochlear implants only represent about 14 frequency channels. Of course, these are spaced across the spectral range of speech. But the crucial thing for these children is to get the amplitude envelope related to that speech. And then if you get an implant as a baby, you can learn spoken language almost as well as a hearing child. So just to make this even clearer, so now I've tried to do a 3D representation, or at least Steven Greenberg, who I found inspirational, he did this first. So the idea is to represent both amplitude and frequency in a 3D space. So we've got time along here. And now we've got a representation for the syllable in the word 7. So these are the higher frequencies at the back, these are the lower frequencies at the front, and you can see there's a very strong amplitude rise time cue for that stressed syllable, the sv of 7, and then there's a much weaker rise time cue for the unstressed syllable. And these rise time cues are particularly important in these lower frequency areas of the speech signal. So you could also try and pick out the individual phonemes. You could say, well, the sr is somewhere here in this frequency, high frequency region, the r. The vowel will coincide with the peak of the amplitude modulation. But the really important thing here is to think about it from the perspective of the brain. The brain is having to represent this whole 3D landscape. And here's a very important cue to structure these different rise times. And as I already mentioned, in language after language, I had PhD students finding that children with dyslexia can't really hear these rise times. So a typical task would be the so-called cartoon dinosaur task. So these dinosaurs move and they make a noise. So if you're trying to do, say, a pitch discrimination, one might be dee, dee, and you pick the higher one. For rise time, it's the rate of onset of the sound. So it would be something like whoop, whoop. The second one would have a quicker rate of onset. So the children are trying to make these discriminations. They get little rewarding pictures when they get it right. Actually, I don't know how to go back. Back, yeah. And these are the kind of tasks that we use to show this sensory problem with perceiving rise time. That problem seems to be there from infancy. So this is just another example of some ongoing research. So I've started doing baby studies to really try and get at these problems from the beginning. So we've had a study running with Dennis Burnham at the University of Sydney now for 7 years. And we've been following infants who are at family risk for dyslexia, so one or both parents have dyslexia, since they were babies. We've been giving them these different phonology and acoustic tasks, and we've been able to show that in the at-risk group, so we still don't know who will have dyslexia, but probably around 60% of the family risk group will have dyslexia. This rise time parameter is already perceived less well when the babies are in their first year. The babies are showing phonological problems in the sense of these early markers of the phonological system, like phonological constancy, which is recognizing the same word spoken by different people. So I'm saying dog, he's saying dog, you know, someone else is saying dog. Is it the same word? That's phonological constancy. Learning brand new words, that's also working less well in these infants at risk for dyslexia. By the time they're 3, you can show that they've got significantly smaller vocabularies, with individual differences predicted by how well they could hear this amplitude rise time when they were babies. And now we've just finished analysing the four-year-old data, so they're still not at school, and this is the chime bar task, and they're finding that task very difficult. They can't really hear which rhythm patterns are the same or different. So I think this is something that's there from birth. It's not something the child has any control over. If their brain isn't resolving these amplitude rise times very well, it's going to have an effect on phonology. So another way to try and tackle the problem then, because of course we want to try and invent interventions to help them, is to try to look at the amplitude envelope and try and model its structure. Because there must be structure within the envelope that the brain is using to lock onto that gives you the speech percept. So I already mentioned that we know from the adult neuroscience that there are lots of different temporal rates nested in the speech signal. What we did in the lab was try to apply so-called demodulation analyses. So you're trying to unpack further the structure within those all those changing amplitude modulations in this seascape I've described, because there might be some that are very systematic. And we thought we'd use English nursery rhymes because we know that they have a language learning utility. They're also fun and children enjoy them. So nursery rhymes modelled from this amplitude demodulation perspective turn out to be very systematic structures. We modelled about 80 different nursery rhymes, and they all showed three bands of amplitude modulation at roughly 2 hertz, 5 hertz and 20 hertz. So that would match these neural oscillations in the delta band, the theta band, and the beta band. And to cut a long story short, here's an example. So we've got time along this axis. We've got frequency going into the background. So the blue colours are high frequencies. The red colours are low frequencies. And then we've got amplitude on this axis. And you can see the amount of amplitude Q, amplitude change, for the stressed syllables. Jack and Jill went up the hill. But there's also a clear amplitude modulation change for the unstressed syllables as well. So the brain must be using all of this information. And what was interesting is how regularly these three rates came out. So across the spectral range of speech, in these deliberately rhythmic speech types, like nursery rhymes, we would get these three amplitude modulation bandings. And if you think about what we do with babies, we often sing nursery rhymes to them, or we sing other songs to them and so on. And in a way, that's like the tapping to a beat, because you've got a beat structure that you're trying to match with your language. And so what that means in terms of this amplitude modulation hierarchy is everything should be perfectly aligned. It's just like the Irish dancers. You have an external beat rate that you're matching with your singing. And that means that from the point of view of the baby, you've got this amplitude modulation hierarchy in a perfect temporal coordination. And again, if you look at lullabies sung to babies across languages, they're sung at a beat rate of 2 hertz. Mothers naturally seem to converge on this beat rate, and we know that this is also the oscillatory rate that sits at the top of this information hierarchy. So that means that in terms of the language learning brain, all of these things we do with babies, like singing, nursery rhymes, and so on, are giving them that amplitude modulation structure in the sort of best possible way for their brains to learn. So, in fact, I would argue from some of my infant data that the brain begins with this landscape of 2 hertz modulations. So here we've got the speech signal with the amplitude envelope in red, and this would be all the different frequencies with the higher frequencies at the back. And this is just showing you this speech signal with only the 2 hertz modulations. I think that's where the baby's brain begins to build a language system. And you can hear these modulations through the fluid in the womb, at least for the low frequencies. And in fact, if you look at the amplitude modulation structure of natural sounds in our environments, you find these amplitude modulation hierarchies. So this is work from Rich Turner, who's an engineer in Cambridge, who did a PhD on what he called amplitude modulation cascades. So he was trying to look at natural sounds in our environment like fire, wind, thunderstorms, and see what the modulation structure was like. And we used his demodulation algorithms to also look at nursery rhymes and infant-directed speech or motherese. So in these figures, you've got time on this axis, and now you've got modulation rates. So these are the slowest rates at the top, like delta, 2 hertz, His theta, 5 hertz, and going up to faster, like 40. And you can see that infant-directed speech has this incredibly elegant and simple structure. It's mainly got this energy content or modulation content at this 2 hertz band, and then sitting on top of that in a sort of nested fashion is this slightly faster 5 hertz band. So in terms of the brain oscillations, that would be delta and theta. By contrast, if you look at a man-made sound, like a cement mixer, so say that cement mixer is going at roughly 9 hertz, so you're hearing tuk, 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 tuk. That would just look like this in terms of its modulation structure. There's just one key modulation rate, and it's incredibly repetitive. It's not a natural biological sound. Whereas if you look at something like a river flowing, so this is from Rich's thesis, now you've got more modulation structure. So it's not necessarily delta and theta. We've got something happening actually more like this is 7 to 9 hertz. There's other things happening over here. It doesn't look the same as Mother E's, but it's got an amplitude modulation hierarchy in there. And of course, birdsong as well. So this is an example of a goldfinch singing. So we've got the delta rate here, theta would be roughly here. In fact, in birdsong, there's a lot more going on at the higher frequencies compared to infant-directed speech. But this is to try to really convince you that these amplitude modulation cascades or hierarchies are a fundamental component of the sounds in our environment. And particularly for language-learning infants, this delta-theta arrangement of the amplitude modulations in the signal could be very important. And so that's exactly what we try to measure in our brain imaging. So I mainly use electrophysiology. We've got the infant brain and we've got the child brain. So this is children with developmental dyslexia versus children without. This is just typically developing infants. And what we're interested in is how early, how efficiently the dyslexic, the brain can lock onto these different amplitude modulation signals in speech, and whether we can find individual differences that could help explain dyslexia. I'm just going to show you two examples because we're getting to the end of our 45 minutes. So one thing you can do with these electrophysiological recordings is you can use the brain's output to try to recreate the stimulus the brain heard. So it's called speech resynthesis or stimulus reconstruction. You can only do it for the lower frequency regions with EEG. So what I'm showing you here is the black line would be the 2 hertz amplitude modulation in a sentence. These were full word sentences. And then the blue in this case is the child's brain response at the group level for chronologically age-matched controls to children with dyslexia. And the green band is for children who had the same reading level as the children with dyslexia but were 2 or 3 years younger. And the basic thing one can see is that for this delta band envelope, the dyslexic brain is showing a much noisier representation of the signal compared to both control groups. In fact, the most fidelity in terms of the brain and the speech is for the youngest children. And that's probably because they've got less other knowledge to try to predict what these sentences are going to be about. But certainly, statistically, we were able to show that in the delta band, but not the theta band, the dyslexic brain was not encoding the speech signal as precisely as it was for other children. This is another example of a paradigm we use, so the so-called bar-bar paradigm, which is rhythmic speech. So children are watching a talking head and someone is saying bar, bar, bar at this 2 hertz rate, and every now and again a syllable is out of time, so bar, 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 and the child has to press a button whenever the syllable's out of time. You can calibrate the task so that children are succeeding about 70% of the time. So you've got the children with and without dyslexia performing at the same level. And then you look in the brain. And what this is showing you, again, is a response in the delta band. So now we've got, this is basically a whole cycle of a brain response, but plotted as a circle. So it's called a rose plot. So we've got 0 degrees going all the way around to 360. And because the brain is not precise, you'll have oscillations occurring or brain cells firing at any point in this cycle. The key thing for a brain that's being entrained to the speech signal is that certain petals should be much longer than others. If there was no entrainment, this would just be a solid circle. The fact that these petals are longer shows that entrainment is occurring. The brain networks are being captured by the speech signal. But what we found was that the children with with dyslexia versus without dyslexia were showing a peak in the oscillatory response at different time points. So the dyslexic brain was slightly out of time. It's like those Irish dancers being slightly off the beat. And again, this was in the delta band, not in the theta band. So yeah, I forgot this slide was next, but so that's exactly what it would be like. It's as though the rest of the dyslexic brain is performing its jobs on time, but the sampling network that's job is to get these 2 hertz amplitude modulations is somehow slightly off the beat. So in terms of speech perception, that would actually be rather a nuisance, because basically, so I've exaggerated it in this graph, but say this is the 2 hertz oscillation, and here's your speech, Jack and Jill went up the hill. If your peak brain response is here, well, most of the information in the speech signal is here, but your brain is busy in a trough, your brain is recuperating, as it were. Then you have another peak here where you get some speech information, but here's another very important part of the speech signal, and you're in a trough again. So it means that in terms of the perceptual experience of the child, it's different from that of other children. The child has no control over this, and because you can use other cues to try and recognize speech, their speech comprehension seems to be fine. Their speech production seems to be fine, although we now have data showing that's not the case. But basically, in terms of their perceptual experience of the world, it's a bit like being colorblind. You know, if you're colorblind, you can't really distinguish red and green. It doesn't mean you can't walk around your world. It doesn't mean you can't, you know, sail a windsurf or something. You can't do all sorts of important stuff that the visual field is needed for, but there's certain elements that are difficult. And in this case, that would be an analogy for dyslexia. You can still hear all the other bits of the signal. Your brain is doing a good enough job that you can speak and comprehend very well. But when you have to really be clear about those phonological representations, it's very difficult because you haven't got the same representation as other children have, so your representations don't fit your written language system as well as other children. You have to keep struggling and relearning. So basically, this tries to encapsulate the whole talk. So I'm saying that when the speech signal comes into the brain, there are different jobs for these different networks of oscillating cells in your auditory cortex and probably in other cortices. The problem in dyslexia seems to be particularly with these slower modulations, which reflect stressed syllable patterns or speech rhythm, speech metrical patterns. So this is all bound together for speech perception, but that perception for the dyslexic child is subtly different to everyone else because of this problem with the delta band. So what can we do about it? So I'll just spend the last couple of minutes saying the kind of thing we think you could do. So basically, I have other studies I haven't talked about using different neural imaging methods. They all seem to converge on the problem being with these delta band networks. And I should mention there's also now research in Spanish which shows the same thing. So English is a stress time language according to speech rhythm typologies. Spanish is supposed to be a syllable timed language, but both children in both languages show a problem in this delta band. So we need to think of ways of trying to improve that rhythmic perception. So one of the main interventions we've done is based on rhythmic movement, because as I said, the brain is multimodal and rhythm is multimodal. And I was watching something about Danny Boyle and how he did the Olympics ceremony. And I don't know if you remember, but he had the Industrial Revolution represented by people banging on drums. And the guy who helped him said, oh, you know, we had 1,000 drummers, but I only had a day to train them. And so the person said, well, how on earth could you get 1,000 people coordinated if you only had a day? And he said, well, it was really easy. I just told them, think about the phrase, play the drum so your mum can see you on TV. Play the drum. And he said, they all got it. Now, if you were a child with dyslexia, you wouldn't get it, but maybe we can invert this so that you do use things like drumming and so on to become more aware of the rhythm patterns in speech. And so this is the main intervention we've trialed so far, which is about using oral language, rhythmic language, and matching it to basically your motor modality. So doing things like clapping in time, marching in time, a lot of drumming, so playing bongo drums, the children like bongo drums, in time to different language rhythms in different games that we devise. So the children spend a term doing these oral activities, and then we measure the impact on phonology and reading. And the impact is reasonable. So the effect sizes, so this is reading, non-word reading, spelling and rhyming, the effect sizes are quite big. And then if you try to say, is that because of this improvement in rhythmic entrainment by using the tapping measure, actually it does seem to be. So it's a fairly modest effect, but this was a significant correlation. So this can help these children, but of course it doesn't cure the dyslexia. It's just something that we could start doing much earlier with children who might be at risk. The other grant I have at the moment is we're trying to do signal processing of the speech signal to try to enhance, or as it were, exaggerate these parts of the signal that the brain doesn't seem to be getting. So we're basically making the rise times much more salient, and we're trying to enhance that whole 2 hertz band of amplitude modulations. So the idea would be that if the input signal is clear and strong enough, then maybe we can get the dyslexic brain to be responding at the peak of the wave, so that matching those peak response of the brain with the peak information in the speech signal. I can't tell you really the outcome because this study was massively affected by COVID. So we're trying to do a pre-test, pre-test imaging, get the intervention, post-test imaging design. We've yet to get both groups of children in school at the same time to get these measures, but this is something that could be very promising. And that's the end of my talk.
Q&A session. I request Usha to take seat. And so the audience here, if you would like to ask a question to Usha, please raise your hand and there will be roving mics around and my colleagues will come to you to ask the question. And the people, those who are online, may I request you to go to the Ask the Speaker box. Apparently there is a box like that wherever you're watching online, and the question will come to this iPad. And I can ask you the question, Usha.
Okay.
So let me just see whether there is any question. Anybody wants to ask a question? Okay. Shall we start with the gentleman there?
Thank you very much. You really beautifully talked about speech rhythm and how it was fundamental in developing dyslexia. So my question is, are all deaf people dyslexic? And what about hearing impaired people?
Mm. So the average reading age of a deaf child who leaves school is 9 years old. It's very hard for deaf children to become fluent readers. Obviously, they're not getting phonology through the acoustic dimension. They can still get some rhythm from vibration, also there is some visual rhythm cues on the face. But in general, it's very hard for deaf children to become good readers. And the ones who do best are actually the ones who are in a very linguistic environment through signing. So if they have really good signing from birth, which most of them don't, because you typically when you're born deaf, your parents weren't deaf, so they weren't expecting a deaf baby, so it takes months for anyone to realise. But if you have signing from very early on, so your language system is very rich, then you do better with reading. But otherwise, in general, deaf children have a real struggle with reading. If you're hearing impaired, it's a bit more subtle because as long as you get a clear signal some of the time, it doesn't seem to matter too much. So they've looked at phonological awareness in children with, I think it's called grommets, when they often have glue ear and so on. In general, these children's phonological awareness is a bit off, but it's not terrible, so they learn to read pretty okay. So for the hearing impaired, it depends really on the cause of the hearing impairment. It seems that as long as you get enough quality signal for some of the time, you're relatively protected.
The lady in purple.
Right, thank you very much. That was really interesting. And I have dyslexic issues that run through my family. I'm not dyslexic myself, but my two of my children are. And what they do, though, is they are very either musical or artistic.
Fantastic.
And we often think, looking at it from that point of view, maybe that's some kind of compensation. But I'm very interested in the way that you've sort of used music, particularly in testing your subjects as well. And I just wondered, you know, are you saying that if you have a dyslexic child, getting them to learn music is a very good is a good way of starting them off and encouraging them to learn to read as well?
Yes, I think music is really beneficial, but in order to help the phonological system, you have to link the beat structure to language, to beats in language. So being good at an instrument is still a good thing for the child, but if you want to make a difference to their phonology, then they need to link those rhythms and beat structures to the beat structures in the speech signal. So you can be dyslexic and be at the Royal College of Music. I mean, we've done a study, and those students, they're also worse at these amplitude rise times, but of course it's all on a continuum, so they're still better than a lot of other dyslexics.
Max, you want to ask a question, and then
yes,
you can give a mic to Professor Adams.
Which is really fascinating. You mentioned cochlear implant. You know, being an engineer, I just wondered whether any devices like a cochlear implant or even a hearing aid can actually compensate the other face. So basically, you're trying to make it synchronized. But each individual dyslexic child may have slight difference in the time of the out phase. So then through acoustic diagnostic, and then you can design and fine-tune the parameters of the cochlear or hearing aid. Can that be a solution?
In principle, yes, which is why I'm doing that speech filtering research. And I should mention there's a Dutch group who have kind of gone ahead, as it were, because they were using cochlear implant algorithms to enhance just the rise time. So they weren't worried about the delta band. They just, any big rise time in speech, they massively made it bigger. And what they've shown in a recent paper is that normalizes speech and noise perception for adults with dyslexia. So trying to change the signal could be a very good way to go, certainly in terms of this problem.
Professor Adams, please.
In the simple world of physics, things react best to their resonant frequency, which you can simply alter by altering the length of a piece of wood or the capacitor in an electronic circuit. And I wonder, is there anything at all in the brain that you can somehow relate to a resonant frequency? You are keen on 2 hertz, for example. Is there anything in the brain which can be said to have a resonant frequency like this? And if so, would it be possible to tune it?
Yeah. I don't know the answer, is this a simple response. I think for speech, the resonant frequency of 2 hertz seems to be very important because of these cross-language similarities in this modulation being so dominant in baby talk. So I didn't show that, but we've also analysed infant-directed speech, and there's relatively more energy in this delta band compared to adult-directed speech. And there's also relatively more phase synchronization between the delta and theta bands than there is in adult-directed speech. So it may not just be one frequency, it could be the other thing. That the really important thing for perception could be the delta-theta phase alignment in the signal for that listening brain. But these are all very new questions, and people haven't... I mean, ideally, I'd like infant-directed speech from a number of languages to check this. At the moment, we've only got English, and then we've just finished some analysis in Spanish, but that was for child-directed speech. But it's a really important question.
Usha, let's take some questions from online. There are 4 questions, but I'm going to ask you one at a time. Two individuals asked the question, can your theory be linked to short-term memory difficulties?
So, in a sense, so basically, the short-term memory system is part of the phonological system in the brain, because we're rehearsing, like, say, numbers to ourselves to remember a telephone number. And we know that children with dyslexia have poorer short-term memories than other children. The link would be a bit ambiguous, though, because it would be saying that these delta-theta synchronizations are very important for rhythmic memory. It wouldn't be a sort of simple, straightforward link.
Thank you. The second question is, do you have any idea why the timing at delta might be different?
No, but the question would be, well, I don't know, either the networks don't have as many cells or maybe the neural transmitters aren't triggering off the response. There are so many levels at which that could be looked at, and I haven't got an answer. I've only shown
And this. If that is the case, then to answer the questions to Max and Professor Adams about whether there could be an external factor to rectify for that would be at a premature stage then, because if you don't know what causes that delta to be different.
It could be premature, but it's a bit like any problem in mental health. You know, sometimes we know that putting dopamine in will improve a patient. We don't know why it improves the patient, but it's still worth trying. So I think if someone had a strong theory and a good reason, it doesn't mean it's too early.
Great. So before I go to the other two questions, anything from the floor? Yes.
Thank you. Very, very interesting. So I was wondering, you talked about speech and you talked about how you see this rising times difference, right, when you talk to speech. But you also said that dyslexia is a multimodal problem or people in different modalities. Do you see the same issues with visual stimuli, for example? Would the rising time be also different?
We tried looking at that. So about the modalities, I was trying to reassure people that I know all those modalities matter for phonology. I don't think it's been shown that children with dyslexia have visual rhythm problems, but we did have a task where we had cartoon chameleons, and they would suddenly appear against the background, and they could appear at different rates. And we didn't find a group difference in that task, but we've only done one study. So it's, in a way, an open question.
In theory, you could use that if you're changing the amplitude of the speech doesn't work. You could, in theory, could use a different modality to compensate for speech. It would be like synesthesia, would fusion.
It could be pan-sensory. I haven't really looked. Yeah.
There's a question up there, Rhys.
Thank you so much. That's a fantastic talk. I've got so many questions for you. I will just ask one, but on a personal level, I'm Welsh, so I've often wondered when we speak Welsh, why it sounds like we're singing. And I also got doctoral students at the moment who are looking at using different sounds to help visualise and better understand statistical distributions like the normal distribution, Poisson distribution. So that's really interested in how your book might link to that. But I was quite interested in the examples you use for the DD task. And I wonder what factors did you use in choosing them? And do you think it might make a difference if you used examples that were perhaps not as well known, like Harry Potter and Jack and Jill?
So at the time we did that study, which is about 12 years ago, actually it's maybe 15 now, because it got published longer after we did it, we just went for things we thought the children would recognise through pictures. Because there's always a possible memory problem with children with dyslexia. So we wanted to have things like Harry Potter that were highly recognisable. And then the Jack and Jill went up the hill. It was similar. We'd done lots of nursery rhyme stuff with these children, so they knew the pictures for the nursery rhymes. You're basically asking, if it was a brand new speech stream, would they be able to get the DDs? I think they'd still struggle. But it's an empirical question that I haven't looked at. But in a way, when you're learning language, everything's novel, isn't it? So for these babies, they're getting a load of actually continuous stuff that they need to parse into meaningful units. Yeah.
In fact, talking about learning languages, and in the meantime, if the mic can reach to this gentleman, there's a question online. Does this explain why dyslexic children struggle to learn other languages, and how could understanding this mechanism help them?
Well, certainly, I think if you have a problem with phonology, it will be applied to any language. So I think there's very little research, but when the child is trying to learn a language that's got a similar phonological structure to the language they already know, that's easier for any child. If the two languages have quite different phonological structures, that's difficult for any child. So I think that would be magnified for dyslexic children.
Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much for the lecture, and thank you especially for the graphics, which I really enjoyed. This is an off-the-wall question. Is there anything that can be read off from your research and discoveries about the experience of those who have autism? Are there any similarities that you would see, or any sources of help, frankly?
Yeah. Well, certainly autism can be characterised by flattened prosody. So the children don't really use prosodic structure as much as we might. They sound a bit telegrammatic and sort of... But when people have looked at their auditory system, there doesn't seem to be a problem with amplitude rise time. If anything, their hyperacute acusis, I think it's called, where you every sound, you hear it so clearly that it can be actually quite distressing, and pitch seems to be a particular problem. So I suppose not really. You know, children with autism can be hyperlexic. They can be fantastically quick to learn to read. They can read things way beyond their comprehension level, but they can pronounce very accurately. So I think it's quite a different brain.
A question there from Professor Bob Nichols.
Thank you, fascinating talk. I have to say, so I'm dyslexic, and I had a horrible childhood.
Can you dance?
No.
No.
I can't speak another language. And basically, in school, I was told I was stupid. I mean, it's as simple as that. Anyway, this is not about me, it's about you, so sorry. So I did have a burning question, which is, so this two hertz, which is clearly very important, do you think is nature or nurture? Because clearly, as you pointed out, the child in the womb can hear the two hertz. The two hertz will travel farther, right? Because it's longer wavelength. So I wonder if the baby is picking up on that sort of rhythm of two hertz, so comes out expecting a two hertz signal.
Yes.
And is there just something in the development of the very early brain that they don't get that two hertz, or there's something going on? Have you investigated the nature versus nurture? Is it because we talk at two hertz that we use two hertz, or is it because it's something ingrained in humans?
Yeah, so I haven't personally investigated that, but there's a lot of human activity that we do as groups that seems to go to this beat rate. So like if audiences clap in time, they tend to go onto that beat rate. If you analyse lots of different genre of music, so jazz versus classical, 120 beats a minute, that's the classical rate for music across different types. We've actually done a demodulation analysis of music, because one of the sort of big questions in the auditory neuroscience of music is, oh, how come the modulation peak in speech is 5 hertz, which it is for adult-directed speech, whereas in music, the modulation peak's at 2 hertz. But from my perspective, well, the modulation peak in baby talk is also at 2 hertz. This is where the systems begin. It's literacy that changes the adult brain and gives you this theta peak, because all of these auditory neuroscience experiments in the literature, they're done on undergraduates at universities, very literate brains. We need to do similar experiments with illiterates, and many people in the world are illiterate, to really say, oh, the modulation structure of speech is different from music. So I think there's something fundamental about this two hertz in nature. That would be the strong claim. And for our speech, it's partly how our articulators work. You know, it's very hard to not speak in stressed and unstressed syllables. You sound very weird if you stress every syllable at the same rate. And the way most people's jaws move is governed by the same mechanism, so you're producing rather predictable modulation structures. That would be the way I'd look at it, but I don't have data.
In fact, there is a question online about the two hertz as well, and this seems to be a right time to ask that. Are there any link between the two hertz and the speed of rocking babies?
That's a really good question, which I don't know the answer to. But when you sing a lullaby, you probably are. So there's been definite cross-language research saying that the lullaby rate converges on 500 milliseconds, which is 2 hertz. So probably the mother is rocking. But you can tell the questioner that we are trying to look at that in our baby study, because we have, these bouncing songs we do with babies, like horsey, horsey, don't you stop, and you're bumping them up and down on your knee. And we've tried to measure using motion capture whether there's individual differences between parents in how synchronized in time the motor and the voice is, and whether that's going to have an impact on the language acquisition of the infant.
How fascinating. Absolutely. There's another question online, and I'll come to the audience after that. As a parent of a 6 and a 9-year-old, my eldest has dyslexia diagnosis. Where can I access more information about the 10-week rhythm program you ran?
We've actually got a portion of our website. I think it's called Public Understanding of Science. And if they go onto that portion of the website, there's documents called Ideas for Teachers and Educators. And that basically gives you these different routines that we do with the children. And also most of our papers are on the website. And there's a paper where the senior author is Bide, B-H-I-D-E. And in the appendix of that paper is the entire routine of what you do.
Thank you very much. I hope the person who asked the question, you get all the details. Otherwise, please play back the video and I'm sure you'll get that's the captured content. Question, yes, please, from Charlie.
Thank you. Has much work been done on how organisations and businesses can better integrate people with dyslexia? Because when you look around, there are obviously some hugely successful, brilliant people.
Yes.
My sort of generation, who probably never knew they had dyslexia, had the same experience that we just heard about as a child. And one senses that organisations could benefit from that diversity in the same way work has been done on autism and so on.
Yeah, I would say it hasn't gone as far as it could. And even in schools, this idea that the child is stupid and isn't trying, that idea is still there because the children are very bright children. So when they're not learning, they're not trying. But actually, they're trying incredibly hard. But one thing I think is really transforming the environment for the workplace is some of these new apps that are being invented. So if you're dyslexic, you can have an app where you type in a spelling and it tells you what the pronunciation is, or vice versa, you say a word and it gives you the spelling. Because a lot of the problem for these people is not that they don't know the language, but it takes them that much longer to process it, which is why they get extra time in exams. But so in the workplace, that those kind of apps could make a big difference to the productivity of. And as you said, when I was writing my most recent grant, I'd read this statistic that one of the benefits of the dyslexic brain is apparently in cybersecurity. If you look at GCHQ and you look at who they hire as their apprentices, in cybersecurity, a quarter of hiring's developmental dyslexics, which isn't true in any other area, because somehow their brain is thinking outside the box in a different way to all these brains that have been drilled to go left, right, along lines of print. And they can have other solutions that people, you know, with a typical brain will struggle for.
So there you go, Bob. Your next career, 007. I have a question for you, Usha. You just highlighted that how reasonable adjustment of extending the exam time helps our students and learners within the higher education sector to cope with their neurodiverse brain. When you are delivering a live lecture, what would be your suggestion based on your research for them when we know that on an average 15 to 30% of our students well might be either dyslexic or they may not even know that they're dyslexic?
Well, I think there's nothing wrong with their listening comprehension. So when you're delivering a lecture, if it's a well-structured lecture, there's no way they wouldn't be able to follow it as well as other students. But I think one thing we learned at Cambridge is that during the pandemic, having the lectures go online, then students can replay them for themselves at their own pace and take their notes. That seemed to be really popular with students. So just off the top of my head, that would be something that would be very supportive for these neurodiverse students, because I don't think they'd have a problem understanding in the lecture theatre, but getting it down and having enough time to process all the, you know, thoughts that go with it, being able to play back the lecture would be very important.
Thank you very much. Thank you. One question from Vibhakshi.
Thank you. has there any study being done about the incidence of dyslexia, for example, between that and the ethnic background of people? For example, you talked about the rhythm and the child's reaction to rhythm. People of certain ethnic background have a tremendous affinity to rhythm, to understand, to react to rhythm. So I'm just wondering if there's anything in there.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's looked specifically at that. That's a really interesting idea. Certainly the cross-language studies say that the incidence of dyslexia is about the same in every language. It's the manifestation that can vary. So in a language like English, which is difficult to learn to read, the manifestation is more obvious than if you're Italian. You know, you can hide it much better. I can't think of anyone who's thought of looking at that, no. So I suppose my answer would be that within your language environment, however good you are at rhythm, you still need to get the rhythms of your language to not become dyslexic. So it may be that actually it won't make much difference, but it's really an open question.
Mm. Max, you want to ask another question?
I think I just respond to Charlie's question. I think in that report we wrote the Prime Minister's Council for Science Technology. We recognize dyslexia, or among other sort of learning difficulties, dyscalculia and autism and so on. The key is early detection and a diagnosis. Yes. And then, you know, the need in the report, one of the key recommendations is the number one recommendation is to have the whole school system, the education system, recognize, and this is a learning difficulties that we need to provide early diagnosis and early support.
Yes.
To overcome the stigma, I think Osama mentioned, you know, some part of society, this is, you know, still kind of, oh, you know, we don't want to tell the parents don't want to recognize. But I think this is very critical as part of the education policy. I think
the government
is implementing this now.
So one thing we're exploring is whether just passive listening to someone saying ta, ta, ta at 2 hertz could be a predictor of whether you might be at risk for dyslexia or not. So in the infant study, we've been recording them since they were 2 months old, and now they're 3.5, but we're, you know, beginning to analyse some of our language measures. Because something like that, which is just a passive task, you'd just be listening for 5 minutes, very easy to analyse the EEG, that could be a very early marker.
Yes, please. And this one might be our last question, and then we will try to wrap up.
I just wanted to follow that up. My name's Helen Clack, and I'm chairman of Surrey County Council. So we're a special educational needs authority. And I have been a councillor for a long time, and over the last particularly 5 years since we introduced ECHP plans instead of SEN statements, the amount of people coming forward requesting those plans, parents for their children, has hundredfold, you know, increased to the point where, you know, schools find it really quite hard to cope, and certainly ed psychologists find it very hard to process the amount of people that have come forward that because the plan has changed, and because they want to see or parents to see much more those problems earlier on and want something done about them now. And so the work, you know, I'm just thinking, I absolutely agree with you. If we could do more work for these young children when they're really tiny, working with their parents, mm-hmm. you know, particularly training their parents to get them ready for reading in the ways that you're sort of beginning to describe, then, you know, we might be making an enormous breakthrough. I think the work that you've done is amazing, actually.
Thank you.
You know, absolutely amazing. And as I say, it's really very urgent because of the amount of people that are coming forward and identifying their youngsters.
But you see, a whole oral genre has sort of gone from childhood. You know, we used to spend much more time interacting with our children, singing, playing games. Now they're often plonked in a screen, or they're
doing. We're all at work.
Pardon?
We're all at work.
Yeah, these are things that the baby's brain needs, you know, and if you just miss out on it, then they're going to come to school with much less skills than they would have had in the past. So trying to start teaching phonics at 5, it's too early, actually, because they haven't got that language foundation that the 5-year-olds might have had 20 years ago. It's all.
So things like Peppa Pig and, I can't remember, well, they're probably not incredibly good for youngsters.
Well, it needs to be a live voice, I'd say. So just hearing someone on TV sing nursery rhymes does not have the same impact as having someone looking into your eyes, so that's somehow very important, and singing with you. But it has a very different effect on the language learning brain.
And that absolutely affirms that learning is a very socially constructive process where you really need live people to come together. Sadly, we don't have any more time to really continue this very exciting conversation. And thank you very much, Usha. What a wonderful research that you're pursuing. And just seeing how the scientific mind works in your head and with your team, how deep you delve into the detail of those neurons in the brain. You know, it's some of the things that you talked about went really way above my head as an economist.
No.
But honestly, it's fascinating to see how much of effort you put into it. May I just request the audience to show our appreciation to have this opportunity to hear from Usha. See, in honor of Professor Alf Adams and Sir Martin Sweeting, both of whom are here, I would like to give you this opportunity to hand over the present of Adam Sweeting Award to you on behalf of this initiative at the university.
Goodness. That's lovely. Thank you very much. Wow,
thank you very much. Thank you. And I'm sure we can get together with the two eminent professors in which name you have been honored. Just wanted to give my regards and thanks to all of you. Thank you very much for coming to this fascinating lecture. Adam Sweeting lecture series is the most prestigious public engagement of science and technology and social science we do from the University of Surrey. This is obviously not going to be the last one. The next one would be in the autumn, and the details will be available very shortly on our website. So thank you very much to everybody, and let's give Usha another round of applause, please.